I want to explain a little bit about what the Lean Forward Moment panel is, since many of you have not been here before, been to EditFest before. This is a little bit different than the other panels you will have seen, in that I've asked each of these editors to choose a scene from something that they did not edit, and to talk about it. And the reason why I'm doing that is that one of the ways in which we involve audiences in the stories that we want to tell is by creating specific moments on screen, and we may do that. We do that by changing things on screen, going from a wide shot to a close-up, changing the pace, introducing a piece of music, taking away sound, whatever it is, we create change, and the audience inside leans forward and pays a little bit more attention to what's going on up there. What I've basically asked these three panelists is to choose something. I didn't use these words, but are their own personal lean forward moment films, in the sense of things that impacted them early on, either in their career or before their career, why they decided to go in to this business entirely, or things that they return to frequently because they're just so awesome. And so their lean forward moments themselves, and that's what this panel's about. The other thing that makes this lean forward moment panel different than previous lean forward moment panels is each of these people mentored each other in a certain way. So Lynne mentored Kelley, and Kelley mentored Chris. Chris is passing that on. Lynne also was mentored by other people. So this is a panel that I think is also about mentoring. And it's about how we pass along the things that are important to us as editors. How the people who we work with can learn from us. And I really hope that those of you in the audience will be able to seek out that from your mentors, and if you don't have one, you'll seek out a mentor to get this from. Or if you're editors, that you accept that responsibility of passing it along to other people. And this is at the core of what this panel is about. So why don't we start down with Lynne?
I'm Lynne Willingham.
Yeah.
And I did The X-Files, Breaking Bad, True Blood, Ray Donovan, and I just finished a pilot called Claws. I am Kelley's mentor, which makes me incredibly proud. Kelley was my assistant on the Breaking Bad pilot. She was my assistant before that and kept urging me to leave the show we were doing so we could do something really fun. And we got the pilot of Breaking Bad, which, of course...
You got the pilot of Breaking Bad.
I got the pilot of Breaking Bad, and Kelley came with me, which was super. And, you know, sort of the rest is history for both of us, actually for all three of us, because it was the show that just keeps on giving. And... I guess that's about it.
Well, good segue to Kelley.
My name is Kelley Dixon. Lynne was my mentor. Let's see. I was an assistant for an embarrassingly long amount of time. But I met Lynne on a miniseries for NBC. And I was really, really excited because she and one of my other mentors who's out there in the audience, Chris Willingham. Stand up, Chris. I kind of looked at these two as the editing powerhouse, and I knew of Chris because he was editing my favorite show, 24 at the time, three-time Emmy winner of 24. And I knew Lynne because she was editing another one of my favorites, which was The X-Files. And I actually got the job with another friend of mine who's an editor. His name is Juan Garza. And we went on to this miniseries, and I was an assistant who basically roved among four or five editors. And then Lynne got a procedural on a network, and she asked me to go, and I was like, absolutely, because every single assistant that you had that had assisted you was already moved up, and it was editing. So I was like, okay, this is my chance to go and cut. So I went to work with her, and I was constantly saying, you're better than this, you're better than this, you're better than this. We can do better, you can do better, you can do better. And cable was just sort of getting started at the time. Lynne had been doing a lot of network stuff that was going 24 episodes a season, and she was very reluctant to go on to something that was 10 or 13 episodes a season. And then Vince Gilligan, who she knew from The X-Files, got in touch with her. And she comes in the room. I've told this story before, but I'll be quick. She comes in the room, and she closes the door. And I'm like, why are you closing the door? And she's like, I got a pilot. And I'm like, you're not going to go do it. She's like, I'm going to go do it. It's Vince Gilligan. I'm like, ah, yes, oh, my God. And she said, well, maybe you should stay here. Maybe they'll make you an editor. I'm like, no effing way. Let's go. Because to me, it was a win-win. I would either move up or I would stay her assistant, and both of those were win-wins. So I moved on to Breaking Bad, and from there I did, good Lord, I did actually Luck, which is a great segue. I did the pilot for Luck, which was my second job. Michael Mann's assistant called me up out of the blue on a Saturday at 5:30 and asked me to go meet him. And I did Luck, I did The Walking Dead, I did Better Call Saul, I did Shameless. I can't even remember. I just finished a pilot for Fox called The Passage, and I did the Preacher pilot and a couple other things. And that segues to Chris, because I met Chris on the Luck pilot, and he was an awesome assistant, one of three or four.
Oh, thank you.
Segway.
I'm Chris McCaleb. Kelley Dixon was my mentor. And I had been an assistant since, I guess, my first gig was in 2005. It was on the Michael Mann movie, Miami Vice. I had worked on a bunch of different, you know, the good one. The one everybody remembers as the best movie they've ever seen. And but it was an incredible experience. And then I took several years off in the wilderness making, writing and directing stuff on the internet with some friends. And then that didn't work out financially. And so I went back to work, and I was working on the pilot of Luck, the Michael Mann, you know, because they always want you back if you've been there. And I know some people in the audience have been through that world, and it's uniquely challenging. And Kelley, we met there.
Which part of that, the pilot or the Michael Mann part?
The Michael Mann part.
Oh, okay.
But incredible opportunities that you get working there to learn. And that's where we met. And we stayed in touch for several years. And then we didn't work together until this 2012, this short run ABC series. And she was going to be going back to the final season of Breaking Bad. And she couldn't take me because she had an assistant there. And while we were working on Red Widow, her assistant retired from the business. And she said, do you want to go work on Breaking Bad?
And do you know what he said? Let me think about it.
Well, I was a huge fan of the show. And I, you know how it is when you're working on something, you can't just watch it. You know, you're in it. And it was a very easy, quick decision. I thought about it for about 3 seconds. And it has been... changed my life, and I've gone on to edit on Better Call Saul with Kelley, and shows like Halt and Catch Fire, Fear the Walking Dead, and most recently the new season of Narcos.
So I also heard in there that you were doing some mentoring for Lynne as well, is what it sounded like.
I was pushing Lynne.
We're calling it mentoring for this panel.
If you work with Kelley and she wants something, it's like you have your own agent. A week did not go by where she wasn't saying to me, we have to get out of here. We just have to get out of here. You have to go and do something because I need to move up. You know, it was like...
I never said that.
It was in the back of your mind.
No, it was mostly because I felt like you were kind of being wasted. I felt like Lynne was so talented. I mean, seriously, I was not blowing smoke. She was so talented. And she was, just doing the stuff that, I mean, I'm not trying to belittle that job, but I'm like, Lynne was super talented. And I felt like she was really not being utilized in the best way. We tried to do some sort of creative things on that show, and they would just get shot down. I'm like, So, but you know what? I always say, people who know me know I say this. I always say, you know what? The right thing's going to happen. And that was the right thing. I mean, I was an assistant for an embarrassingly long time, but boy, I hit the lottery on that one.
Well, the interesting thing, too, was I wasn't looking for anything, because she's right, I would have stayed there. I was supposed to cut the showrunners, the finale in the show, the first thing he had directed I think, on the show, and it was like, I knew him, I didn't want to disappoint him, and then Vince's assistant called and said, Vince... Vince has a pilot, and he's wondering if you'd be interested in say it. And I said to him, tell him I'll take it. And he goes, would you like to read the script? I said, yeah, sure, but tell him I'll take it. Because anything that Vince writes is worth doing. And I mean, seriously, I took the job before even reading the script because of Vince.
So let me ask, before we start to look at the scenes, let me ask you this question then. Do you feel you've also been, therefore, mentored by Vince in a certain way?
No.
Okay.
No. I mean, I worked with Vince on The X-Files, but and we had a very nice collaboration, but I would not call him a mentor. I would call him an amazing partner and someone fabulous to work for. But in the true sense of mentoring, no, he expected my game was there when I got there. I'd say the very first producer who honestly ever mentored me was someone who moved me up for the first time as an editor in a studio where there was an awful lot of work, but you know, he decided I should be up. And he really taught me some things about editing that I didn't know. When I got to Vince, I knew how to edit. So those kinds of things weren't important. It was freeing to work with someone like him because he's brilliant. But I think our game was there, you know, and he expected that.
Okay. Well, so without a segue now, I'm going to move into taking a look at some of the scenes that inspired you or continue to inspire you, whatever. Each of the panelists have chosen one scene. We're going to take them, why don't we take them in that order? So, Kelley, why don't we start with you? And there we go. We're going alphabetical here.
All right.
Because we're editors. We're anal retentive, so.
All right. My scene is from what I still feel, I think it was a 1992 movie, but I still feel is probably the best edited piece of work I've ever seen. Not necessarily this scene, but just the whole movie. And it's JFK. And just so you all know, you probably don't realize, you guys are all kind of young. This movie was cut on VCRs. I don't know, you guys probably never even had VCRs. Right? You know what VCRs are though, right? Right. This movie was too early to be cut digitally, and it was too complicated to be cut on film. There was archival footage that was coming in on all kinds of mediums from Super 8 and tape and all kinds of different tape and film and just all kinds of mediums. And what they did was they decided to bump it all to 3/4 and they edited on from tape to tape, VCR, record, hit, play. I don't like that. Go back, hit, play, just, you know. So I still think it's quite amazing just for that reason, but I'm also a big fan of both of these editors. Actually, I think I apologize for this. There are two editors credited in the front. They were Oscar winners that year, Pietro Scalia and Joe Hutching. But it is an amazing piece of work. The clip that I'm showing, I guess what I love about it is because not only is the technique just so amazing and the choices that they made are so amazing, but what I love about it is it really is a film about memory and about how, and it basically puts you as an audience member into other people's memories by using real footage, by using real archival footage, by using shot for the movie and made to look like archival footage. What it does is it takes all these mediums, sound as well, takes all these different mediums, and it puts them in a very experiential, it puts you as an audience member in a very experiential situation. And with my editing, people who know me know that I've said a lot, and I've said it to you, it's always better to be with the character rather than be back watching them do stuff. So that's my clip.
Right. So why don't you just set it up a little bit, right? JFK is about the airport, right?
JFK is a movie about the district attorney of New Orleans. I think he's the only one who has ever brought a court case
around the assassination.
About the assassination of John F. Kennedy. This took place, I believe, in 19... Kennedy was killed in 63. I think this took place in 1967. But anyway, that, you know, just to set this clip up, this is the end. This is the very end of the movie. I'm not really giving anything away because you guys know he died in 63, right? But basically, this is the one of the final court scenes in the movie where the main character, who's played by Kevin Costner, is basically telling the jury. He's giving the jury the rundown of what most likely happened that afternoon when they put together all of the testimony and the Zapruder film, which is really the only, and it actually gives, the Zapruder film actually gives them a timeline according to how these things happen and in what time they happen, because film runs at 24 frames per second, yes, yay, okay, great.
Unless you're in Europe. All right, let's be international here.
All right, so that's my clip.
Okay, so let's roll a clip from JFK.
We have the epileptic seizure around 12:15 p.m., distracting the police, making it easier for the shooters to move into their places. The epileptic later vanished, never checking into the hospital. The A-team gets on the sixth floor of the depository. Now, they were refurbishing the floors in the depository that week, which allowed unknown workmen in and out of the building. They moved quickly into position, just minutes before the shooting. The second spotter on the radio talking to the other two teams has the best overall view, the guard spot. B team, one rifleman and one spotter with the headset and access to the building, moves into the low floor of the Daltex building. The third team, the C team, moves in behind the picket fence above the grassy knoll where the shooter and the spotter are first seen by the late Lee Bowers in the watchtower of the rail yard. They have the best position of all. Kennedy is close and on a flat, low trajectory. Part of this team is a coordinator who's flashed security credentials at several people chasing them out of the parking lot area. Probably 2 to 3 more men are down in the crowd on L. 10 to 12 men, 3 teams, 3 shooters. The triangulation of fire Clay Shaw and David Ferry discussed 2 months before. They've walked the plaza. They know every inch. They've calibrated their sights. They practice on moving targets. They're ready. Kennedy's motorcade makes a turn from Maine onto Houston. It's gonna be a turkey shoot. They don't shoot him coming up Houston, which is the easiest shot for a single shooter in the book depository. They wait. They wait till he gets to the killing zone between 3 rifles. Kennedy makes the final turn from Houston onto Elm, slowing down to some 11 miles an hour. The shooters across Dealey Plaza tighten, taking their aim, waiting for the radio to say, green, green, or abort, abort. The first shot rings out, sounding like a backfire, it misses the car completely. Frame 161, Kennedy stops waving as he hears something. Conley's head turns slightly to the right. Frame 193, the second shot hits Kennedy in the throat from the front. Frame 225, the president emerging from behind the road sign. You can see that he's obviously been hit, raising his arms to his throat. The third shot, frame 232, hits Kennedy in the back, pulling him downward and forward. Conley, you will notice, shows no signs at all of being hit. He is visibly holding his Stetson, which is impossible if his wrist has been shattered. Conley is turning here now. Frame 238, the fourth shot. It misses Kennedy and takes Conley in the back. This is the shot that proves there were 2 rifles. Conley yells out, my God, they're going to kill us all. Somewhere around this time now, another shot that misses the car completely strikes James Craig down by the underpass. Breaks. The sixth and fatal shot, frame 313, takes Kennedy in the head from the front. This is the key shot. The president going back and to his left. Shot from the front and right. Totally inconsistent with the shot from the depository. Again, back to the left. Back.
You mentioned that part of the thing that attracted you to this was the variety, the complexity of it. And you mentioned in terms of the different kinds of footage. But it seems to me that there's all kinds of complexity in here in terms of the storytelling and all of that. What are the moments in here that still kind of take your breath away? Are there things like that? Like, what are the elements that are used to create the scene that, as an editor, you just so admire?
I think it's a really hard question to answer, but I think it's mostly that I'm watching them use all different types of film, all different angles, to really illustrate memory for us as an audience. Because when you think about it, the way you remember things just in your life, you remember it, your brain doesn't put them together in linear fashion. It's just a lot of stimulus. And I think that what they've done here is they've basically taken that idea and put it into a tangible form. Part of the draw of this is that they did cut it on VCRs because, I mean, they had to cut. That's linear editing. It's not nonlinear editing. They can't just pick and choose. They have to have a plan, and they have to, you know, do that. So that's part of it. So I think the technique is just, I can't even fathom how, I can't explain how amazing that is. But the other thing about it is that the choices that they made, what they choose to show you, how fast, how slow, to take things, the archival footage, and mix it. You see how they've mixed, things that they shot for that moment, the stuff that looks really, really clear. You know, they went out to Dealey Plaza and they recreated that whole thing and they shot that, but they also took it in ways to make it look archival, and they used that as well. Mm-hmm. And then they also used real archival footage, mm-hmm. and they mixed all of that. They also show different people, and you see how those people were affected by that moment, in the moment. And I think that that's what really
attracted. So that raises, we have a question here on Twitter, which I think is about structure to some degree. Do you go into a scene with a thought out structure, or does that come organically from the material? So when you all are editing, and this is a question for all three of you, do you have a thought out structure ahead of time?
I don't think you can have a plan until you see the film. So if I'm looking at the page, no. If I'm looking at the film, yeah. If you're really lucky and you have a director who has a plan, you can usually tell from the camera, just from what you're getting in camera, what their plan is. And then you just follow it. To me, it's really an organic thing. As long as I know what the story's supposed to be, and the film is, somewhat there. Mm-hmm. When it becomes, obviously when it becomes a little more complicated is when someone threw the script out, only you're supposed to be following it, and they shot something completely different. And then you've got to kind of find the thread of how you can tell this story with the film that you've got. Mm-hmm. And then you're imposing a structure on it becomes much more important than it would be if the director had imposed a structure on it in the camera.
Cool. What about you, Chris? Do you?
Well, I would add to that something that Kelley has always taught me, and which is.
I bet I know what you're gonna say.
Well, it's about keeping your mind open to find a new way into the scene, because like you said, like some directors, they'll have a preconceived notion of how they want to start it. They start on the water bottle, and the camera moves up to the whole audience, and that might be the best way to start it, but it's always an important thing to find another way, to see if there is another way that maybe is more interesting, that's more visceral. Maybe it's a tight shot of somebody's hands or somebody, whatever it is. And the only way you can do that is to watch every frame of your dailies, which is critically important, and unfortunately a lot of something that I've experienced a lot of people not doing. Mm-hmm. But you can't find those new ways in. You can't really explore every possibility unless you've seen everything.
Well, we were talking before we came on about how much footage you get and the number of days of shooting. So What's your typical shooting ratio on an average? Well, I don't know if we can call Better Call Saul average.
That's not average.
but what do you deal with now? How much footage do you get in, and how do you deal with it?
Are you asking me on Better Call Saul?
Yeah, because you're looking right at me, so why not?
The thing about Better Call Saul, and this was true on Breaking Bad too, as Lynn can attest, is that, you know, on those two shows, the average length of a scene is about 6 minutes. Where on most shows, the average length of a scene is about a minute and a half or 2 minutes. So, you know, with a 6 minute scene, you're going to get, you know, you're going to get them doing that whole scene about, I don't know, 15 or 16 times at least. You know, I've learned, I think it was on Shameless that I actually started doing this, and now I'm just gotten real good at it, is I just watch my dailies in quad split. What happens usually is if I put them in quad split, at least I can get my eye used to what is there, you know, and then it's not that, like, if I watched every single piece of my dailies in full screen the whole way through, sometimes I've gotten scenes that I've had 9 hours of dailies in. My whole day would be gone. But, you know, I get really bored. I get bored. I'd want to stop and start doing something else. You know, I just start to fidget. And, you know, so if I put them in quad split, that cuts that time in half, A. And then I can...
So you do A and B cameras.
Yeah, I watch them A and B camera. And usually what happens is they're similar enough so I can at least say, I might not be able to tell you, oh, that take that I want is 1E take 3, but I can tell you, oh, that moment that I saw that camera move over there, I've seen it. So I know it's there, so I just go find it.
You got to keep figuring out how to absorb material with the huge amount that we're getting nowadays.
Yeah, so I would say challenge. That those two shows are not, they're not average. I just worked on a pilot, which was actually nice because it was a little bit, it was a lot different. The work was a lot different than I've been used to in the past year. And it, you know, it was a little breath of fresh air. So I definitely watched my dailies in quad split, but I could, you know, the scenes were shorter and I could engage a lot quicker. I just want to offer between the two, these two guys, as far as like having, you know, an agenda, I usually, when I read the script, I definitely will have like a thought, you know, in my head about what it will look like. But yeah, I can't really make the decision until I get the footage. And then, you know, I guess what I'm saying too is that my decisions go between both of them. You know, I sometimes do what the director says, but most of the time I look for another way in. But I think looking for another way in helps keep you very fresh. It also helps you learn to use footage in ways that it wasn't necessarily designed for.
Cool.
Can I just say one thing also?
Sure.
When we're cutting film, and all three of us do television, so you get a certain array of scenes a day, and the scenes are scattered. They're not shooting a script in chronological order. So if you cut a scene and you're looking at the head of it and you go, okay, the director wanted to come down from that bottle or go tight on that hand or something, well, that's great. It works really well while you put it away. You sit there and you go, okay, I'll cut something else. And then the next day, they bring in the scene that butts up to it. Well, that transition may be crap now. I mean, it may look terrible, which gets you into what Chris was saying about look for another way in. You might be able to use that tight shot on a bottle someplace else, but to go from where you just left a scene to what the director thought he intended in the next scene might really be ugly. And so you do have to be, you do have to go into those flexible places.
So let's use that as a bridging point into your scene, Chris, since you
All
are
right.
number two, right?
That's me.
I know, not much of a bridge, but let's try it anyway.
The scene I picked is from the movie Boogie Nights, which is a movie that inspired me probably more than any movie to get into filmmaking and to study it and to be a part of it. And it's a great film. And the scene that I picked, I mean, it's a movie about people kind of ascending to these personal highs and then crashing hard into terrible, terrible lows of ego and addiction. And this scene comes after kind of a big climactic sequence for a lot of different characters. And some of our main characters are at an all-time low, and they've decided to kind of do a shady drug deal with this maniac rich guy. And
who is your main character?
Dirk Diggler, played by Mark Wahlberg, and some of his cohorts, John C. Reilly, and then Thomas Jane. And they go in and they it doesn't quite go like they think it's going to.
Yeah. All right, well, let's take a look at the Boogie Nights clip.
Whoa.
See something really fascinating. Check it out.
Oh, what?
Huh? That thing's not loaded, is it?
Not yet.
Is that silver?
Look, that's not. Huh? Don't point. Please not point the gun, please. Sir? Todd.
What, you think I can't do it?
No.
Wait,
no.
You think I can't do it?
Sir,
wait. What, you want to see me do it?
You dare me?
Huh?
No, we don't dare you. You dare me? Fucking dare!
Your fucking face is red.
Yeah, I love this. Like, I make these little mixtapes together. You know, I put all my favorite songs together. Hey, Charles, what song is this? Number 11. Yeah, I love it. You know, when you buy a tape or something or an album, you put it on and the songs are like the fans put them in some fucking order. Like they want you to listen to it in that order. You know, I hate that. I fucking hate that. I don't like to be told what to listen to, when to listen to it, or anything.
Fuck.
Cosmo. He's Chinese.
So why this scene? What about it compels you?
There's from the moment they get there, because they're so desperate leading into this moment, and there's something about the way that the picture is cut combined with the sound work and the music to create this like unbridled chaos and anarchy. It's so uneasy at every moment. They're uneasy, you're uneasy watching it. You never know what's gonna happen. And what I love about the scene is not just the shots that we're seeing, but it's the shots that we're not seeing. It's the decision to hold on certain shots much longer than you would traditionally do, and letting, like, playing on a shot of them, and rather than seeing the firecrackers in the background going off, just holding on it and not knowing when that's going to happen, and then it happens, and it's unexpected, and it just keeps you on edge as a viewer. The thing that is not in this clip, because I didn't want to have a 10-minute clip, it's shortly after this. It's as far as like the camera not cutting away, there's like an almost minute long hold on Mark Wahlberg, on Dirk Diggler, as you see everything about his life and his situation just dawning on his face, and he's not doing much, and there's other people kind of half in the frame, kind of coming out, and we just hold on him while the Rick Springfield song Jesse's Girl is playing, and you see every bad decision he's made to lead up to this point on his face, and it happens by not cutting at all. And it seemed very brave. I mean, it seemed like, and this movie in particular has a lot of moments like that that seem to be brave as far as when they don't cut.
That's cool. I like the word bravery on that, and I think we need to be brave. I would also interestingly point out in this first half of the scene, in the section you showed, the Dirk Diggler character is almost non-existent in it. So when he does come in, it's kind of like, whoa. Now, look at how it's affecting him. So there really is, I think, that change on that. It's really great. There's a question. It's important to never stop learning. How do you, as an already successful editor, continue to learn from other editors? No, I pointed to all three.
You're the most experienced and successful.
She just said I'm the oldest, is what she just said. I actually do. I mean, I pay attention to what other people are doing. I probably don't get to watch as much television or films as, you know, I would like to, because we're working all the time. But, you know, I live with an editor. I mean, it's easy. We talk to each other all the time. So as far as that goes, I have an advantage. You know, he can come home and say, well, this happened today, and I can say, oh, well, how about this? Or I can say, okay, so this happened today, and he goes, well, did you think about this? Also, a lot of my friends are editors. I mean, you know, you end up talking to people, and just in the, I can't remember what they call the language of a business, but in the language of editing, you're talking to people who understand your language. So it's just conversation.
So when you're watching movies, are they completely room for you because you're looking at the editing, or what?
Not for me.
Only when it's bad?
Yeah, only when it's bad.
I don't really notice. It's funny. I will mention, though, that I've talked to you about this, and I've definitely talked to you about this. There's what I call the pause your VCR and roll back moment. If you're watching something and you're like, whoa, did I just see that? And I'll pause my VCR and roll back. And the reason I bring it up is because now, especially on Better Call Saul with Vince Gilligan and Peter Gould, especially if they will have me do something, then I'll be like, nah. And they'll be like, well, Kelley, would you pause your VCR on that? And I'm like, yeah, I would pause my VCR. And my feeling about all of that is no editor that I know would ever make a cut like that. And the producer made them make that cut. So,
yeah, I
think it's interesting that you're still watching them on the VCR, too.
Oh, fuck, did I say VCR? Yeah, I'm old school, you know. No, I'm DVR, sorry.
I have the equivalent of that when I'm sitting with the director and I'll go, well, there goes my Oscar. Yeah, it's like you just blew that one. Yeah.
Yeah, they're whiplash moments. They're moments that knock you off the couch and you just go, whoa, what was that person thinking? But again, a lot of times, in all fairness, it probably is a producer or you know, some...
Well, regardless of who it is, there's still things to be learned from edits and editing that doesn't work, right? Is that, I'm hearing, as well as things that do work? So do you have conversations like that with your TV as you're watching it or when you're sitting in a film? What are you thinking about?
You know, sometimes the very best way to learn is to have the worst film in the world, because you really have to work hard to make something look good when either the script hasn't delivered or the director hasn't delivered or for whatever reason you're working really hard to solve problems that you never thought you were going to have to solve in a particular scene. And I know Chris and I worked for 10 years for Stephen Cannell Productions, and we did an awful lot of really terrible television at Stephen Cannell. We did, you know, it was a great studio. It was the busiest studio in town. They did The A-Team. They did, you know, Riptide. They did
21 Jump Street.
21 Jump Street. They did
the original with Johnny Depp.
Yeah, I mean, they did a hell of a lot of television. And consequently, it was like a film school. You know, they had three editors on each show, and they might have had six shows on the air at a time, which was phenomenal. I mean, really phenomenal. But a lot of the television, he was the first studio to move to Vancouver because of a tax break situation or whatever. And he started doing these shows that were they'd shoot for 6 days a week. You'd have two editors and one assistant, and every other week you were in dailies. And it was really some terrible film. I mean, really terrible film. And we both got so fast. I mean, Chris was fast already, but I hadn't been editing that long. You got really good at solving a lot of really bad problems early. It was the best film education I ever had, because I didn't go to film school. And you know, it
is a film school.
It is a film school. A lot of really big people came out of Cannell too. I mean,
Lynne used to tell me all the time that with good film it's easy. It's with bad film that you really learn what to do and mm-hmm. how to solve problems. I was going to mention, too, that, you know, I think with editing, one of the biggest things that you have to do is you have to really, like, start to trust your own instincts. And you have to learn, you know, that you have good, you know, that you that your thoughts are good and to go with those. I think that's one of the hardest things. Mm-hmm. But I also feel like one of the things that, like, I learn constantly is not only about the footage. The footage... I'm not going to say it comes easy to me. I am constantly learning, but more of the learning that I do, and Lynne can attest this because I call her all the time, is, you know, learning how to manage the job, learning how to manage the people, learning how to manage a situation, you know, things like that in the editing room,
well,
not only
great.
About the film.
Could I ask you to hold on to that thought for a minute, because I definitely want to come back to that when we talk about mentoring again. Why don't we take this opportunity to see Lynne's clip? And because this is different than all the other ones.
I picked the piano, and I don't know how many of you have ever seen the piano. It's absolutely a gorgeous film. It was 1993. It was written and directed by Jane Campion, who's an Australian director. It was cut by a woman named Veronica Jennett, or Janae. I'm not sure how you say her name. Three Oscars, one for Holly Hunter, one for Anna Paquin, and one for Jane Campion. The story is about a woman in the 19th century who lives with her little girl at her parents' house in Scotland. And she is sold to a frontiersman in New Zealand and sent on a ship for 3 months with her little girl to marry this guy that she doesn't know. She doesn't speak. She's a mute. Self-imposed mute, no other reason than she just stopped talking when she was 6 years old and communicates completely through the piano. So the clip that I picked is when they've arrived in New Zealand. They have had all of their goods unloaded onto a beach. She is waiting for her husband to come and take her back to his house, and they're left alone on this beach with their piano, because the piano came with them, And that's where we are when this starts.
Great. Let's take a look at the piano.
Miss McGrath, Alistair Stewart. You'll have to wake yourself. I've got men here to carry your things. Well, I see you've got a good many boxes. I'd like to know what's in each. Can you hear me? Oh, that's good. Yes, that's good. What's in this one? You're small. I never thought you'd be small. And this one? Very large. What's in it then? A bedstead? Dad?
It's my mother's piano.
Baines, tell them to carry in pairs. Take all the boxes, table, and suitcases. What do you think?
She looks tired.
She's stunted, that's one thing.
No, just the trucks and boxes. Thanks, Payne. Being a porter. I need to wait the car.
Oh, no, it can't come now.
It must. She wants it to come.
Yes, and so do I, but there are too few of us here to carry it now. Too heavy. What do you mean you don't want your clothing or your kitchenware to come? Is that what you mean?
We can't leave the piano.
Look, let's not discuss this any further. I'm very pleased that you arrived safely.
Mother wants to know if I could come back directly for it.
Could I apologize for the delay, which I regret was...
After they've taken the other things.
Might I suggest that you prepare yourself for a difficult journey? The bush will take clothing and the mud is very deep in places.
What do they think they're doing? We don't have time for this.
Baines.
So why this scene? What about the shaping of the scene do you like?
I like that everybody was introduced. I mean, you met everybody that was important in that scene. You met her husband. You met Harvey Keitel's character, who becomes her lover. The country is a character, and you get to see, because of the way it was beautifully shot, you get to see these wide expanses of New Zealand. You see the first time, I think, that in the whole movie where you go to an extreme close-up is the connection between her and the piano. And when she leaves it, it's devastating. The whole story, for those of you who don't know it, revolves around her getting the piano back. And the deal that she makes with Harvey Keitel's character as a whaler on how she gets the piano back. It's kind of life-changing for her. Her relationship with Harvey Keitel is very life-changing for her. And I think part of it, too, you know, I saw it originally in 1993, I believe that's when it was made. It was such a powerful woman's movie, written by, you know, obviously a very talented woman who also shot it beautifully. And, you know, here was a woman who had no power at all and figured out a way to get her power back because of the piano. And it was very moving to me.
Yeah, so that's great. I actually want to leap off from that, circle back through what Kelley was talking about in terms of the politics of the editing room. Well, you didn't say politics, but just in terms of what goes on in the editing room over and above the simple act of editing, and wrap in another comment that we got tweeted. It says, all three panelists are so connected. Please discuss the fundamentals and importance of choosing an assistant. What are the kind of people you want to work with? And let me throw one additional thing in, especially because you mentioned the piano is a powerful woman's story. What about creating mentorships, especially among people in the editing room who are traditionally underrepresented? People of color, women have been perhaps better in the editing world than in some on sets, but still highly unrepresented or underrepresented. Any issues with that as you were coming up? How do you mentor people across a wide variety of backgrounds? And who do you look for in an assistant?
I look for someone I can spend a lot of time with. I mean, you're going to spend a lot of time with your assistant. So, you know, for me, it's really important that they have an excellent sense of story. They're someone I can bounce off of. I have an assistant now who's been working with me for about 8 years, Susan Godfrey, and she can look at a cut with me and say, okay, this is fine, but what happens here? And then I can look at it differently. Because sometimes when you're on a track and you're going down a road and you're married to what you've just done and you don't want to hear from somebody say, yeah, but you know, something's wrong about that. You know, I don't understand that person's motivation for that. And is there something that can, you know, she can say to me, maybe we might want to stay longer on something. I just like an interaction with my assistant. And
so how do you know that when you're interviewing?
I'm a terrible interviewer. I really am. I assume everybody's going to be great. And don't think I've had very many people that I went, oh, I've got to get rid of an assistant. You know, I don't think I've ever had that happen.
What I've looked for is just, because you're looking for a partner, basically. You're looking for someone you're going to be spending all this time with, which is exactly what Lynn just said. So, you know, you can look at their resume and see what they do. You can talk to their references and get recommendations. But then ultimately, it's just, do you click with them or not? Which is, I mean, that's sort of intangible. You can't really prepare for, as an assistant, I mean, having been an assistant for quite a while, like there's nothing you can do other than to just be yourself. Don't be an asshole, I think is a really good, pardon my language.
That's good number one,
but
actually.
I mean, it's like the best rule you can have in any business, but especially in a relationships business like entertainment. You know, nobody is excited about working with a jerk. So, you know, try your hardest not to be a jerk and surround yourself with people who aren't jerks. And weirdly, you'll have a much better time at work. So, it's true. Would you agree?
And thank you very much.
I mean, that's absolutely. It's a really very, very hard. There's so many aspects to choosing an assistant and how you choose an assistant, what you look for. And, you know, I'm sure that all three of us want to be as helpful and as accessible as possible to, you know, people who are underrepresented. And that's such a, God, esoteric way to put that. But, I mean, you know, but I've always found, I mean, maybe I'm wrong, but I've always found, especially as far as women goes, I've never had a shortage of women or seen a shortage of women in editorial. I've worked for a lot of women. I've worked with a lot of women. I've always, I mean, maybe I'm very naive on the statistics, but around me, it's been a lot of female-centric. As far as people of color, yeah, but that's all over. It's definitely all over. I mean, you know, I don't have the panacea to that either. I really don't. I've done very little interviewing. And I find that I don't think that I'd be very good at it either. I've been fortunate to have sort of a line of people that are just waiting for me to dump an assistant. You know, but I think...
Way to go, Chris. You just yeah, opened I got up dumped. A slot. Yeah.
No, he actually, Chris was one of the people that I was very sad to lose, you know. I mean, I know that this is what we're supposed to do. We are supposed to move, you know. One thing I will say about Chris and I, we have been friends for a long time. We have been friends before we worked together. I mean, we worked together, then we were friends, and we didn't work together, and then we worked together. And our relationship as far as we were partners, you know. I mean, because of the nomenclature, I had to call him my assistant. But towards the end, he was, you know, editing right along with me. And, you know, I shared a bunch of credits. Chris has nominations along with me as, you know, as an editor. So I was very, very sad to, you know, have to lose him. But... You know, it's one of those things where the thing that I really liked about working with Chris and what I'm hoping is that Lynn liked about working with me when I wasn't, like, you know, pestering her to leave was that I didn't have to do much teaching at that point. I mean, I could talk to Chris about, you know, editing a scene and say, hey, tell me what you think. And, you know, what's your point of view here? What are you trying to say? And that's the discussion that we would get into. It was more about talking to another editor about what the scene meant, what it means in your heart, why you would go to that, what you wish the director had given you, you know, how a producer is approaching this entirely incorrectly, which we had a couple discussions about. I'm like, they don't get what this is about. But I think that...
We were right, by the way.
Yeah, we were totally right. But, I mean, you know, it's like... Look, I mean, I've got people who are ready to step into this. And one thing I used to talk to Lynn about, and this is, I guess, you know, a reality about this business, is that I would always tell Lynn, the really good assistants want to go work for her. And she's got, you know, her pick of the best assistants because she gets the jobs. So the really good, she's going to get her pick of the really good assistants. If you're a brand new beginner of an assistant, I mean, look, you can make a go, but most likely you're not going to be in there because she gets her pick of the best ones. And the thing is that they know, the best assistants know that they're going to get to cut with her. You know, they're going to get to edit. You know, by the time, like, I think I'd worked for Lynn for a season of network television, and I asked her, I'd like to cut half the show. How do you feel about that? And she said, yeah. So, and I mean, you know, I would talk to Chris about editing and A friend of mine actually gave me this, my friend Juan Garza, who was a fantastic editor, and I used to assist him, and he said the best way to start is to cut a scene a day as an assistant. Cut a scene a day along with all your other duties, and then start cutting two scenes a day. If you can cut two scenes a day and do all your assistant duties, you're pretty much doing pretty well. You know, but the thing is, you've got to start working, you know, your way up. It's almost like working out. You've got to start getting your chops up. But what that does also does is it gets you into a thing of watching dailies and developing a style and, you know, understanding, you know, how to do it. I think that what I usually try and tell people when they ask me, like, what can I do to break in? What can I do? I think you have to network as much as possible. You've got to go to all these things. You know, the union has, I get emails all the time of union mixers and stuff like that. You got to go to those. And you know what? At some point, maybe, you know, you'll get lucky. But I think it's kind of unrealistic. I hate to say it, but I think it's kind of unrealistic to, you know, necessarily come to one of these things and say, hey, can I meet you for coffee? And then all of a sudden, you've got a job, you know. I think that that didn't happen to me, and so I can't imagine that happens a lot.
So, going off of that, I think it was in the first panel this morning, Edie, I think, mentioned that things are very different in terms of moving up. So when there was this thing called apprentice editor.
I met you when I was an apprentice, Norm.
That's right, you did. Or Lionsgate.
But again, it wasn't like I could go to you and say, hey, Norman, can I work on your next movie? I don't even think I was naive enough to ask you that at that point.
No, you didn't, but now I'm going to ask you. So back then that was training. I could stand next to my editor and see how he or she would talk to their directors or their producers and all that. Is that different today, and if so, how do you sort of compensate for that?
It's interesting because I was going to talk about this anyway. When Kelley was assisting me, she didn't need much from me as far as watching me cut. She has, she's got great instincts. She's a really good storyteller. She's obviously creative and talented, but she wasn't real comfortable working with some of the people that I was comfortable working with, like the director, the producer. I'm pretty even as far as how I manage my room. And maybe it's being the oldest of 12 children. Maybe it's 10 years in retail management.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. I mean, I'm pretty even. I'm very calm most of the time, and I'm very even in a cutting room. And Kelley was like this.
Oh my God.
So the big thing, and all of the editors that I know this, is that you can't take things personally when things go to shit in your cutting room. I mean, you know, when the director is freaking out or something, it may not be you he's really upset with, but you got to be able to maintain a calmness that helps them get calm. And Kelley is a very emotional human being. And so the thing that I felt that I did the most for her in a mentoring sense was not teaching her how to cut film, but showing her how to behave in a cutting room. And
Still.
And bravo for that, really.
I mean,
bravo.
It'll make or break the best editor in the world. You can have all the talent coming out of your fingertips, you know, in the world. I mean, you can have Oscar written all over you, and you can treat everyone badly in your cutting room, and you will never get a job. Your attitude is almost more important than your talent. It's a real nice combination to have both, but it's really, really important.
Yeah.
Great. Well, we just have a few more minutes, so I wanted to, where and how do you find ways to incorporate your own creative voice into your work? Now, we can skip over Kelley because we know how you do that. Right? So I think the question is, if you're editing for someone else, right, for a director, for a producer, how do you make it your own?
Well, I think any project you belong to is your project. So in that respect, you make it your own by just bringing your vision of what the best way to tell that story is with the film you've got. You know, it's all, it's a team effort. It's not the director's movie. It's not the producer's movie, it's not the writer's movie, it's not your movie, it's not the grip's movie, it's not the DP's movie. It belongs to everybody who put something into it. And, you know, because of that, just what you do imparts your voice. I mean, they can change it all they want after you've given your take on the film. And, you know, they probably will change it a lot. In a perfect world, I mean, I think I've heard a statistic, and maybe we all just made it up, but, you know, if they have to change more than 10% of what you've given them, either you're not working hard enough or they're complete jerks. And so a lot of what you see on the screen will be the editor's work, whether it's visible or invisible. And, you know, that's what I think.
I think once you learn to trust your instincts, like Kelley was saying, I mean, that's key. And I know what you always taught me when I would first start cutting scenes, which you're suddenly cutting a 8-minute scene on Breaking Bad, a show you love that has, you know, 10 hours of dailies, and it's got two of the best actors ever. And you're working for one of the best editors ever, and she says, cut this scene. And the best advice she gave me was, don't try to cut it like me. Don't second guess your instincts. Don't be like, well, what would Kelley do, or how can I? You just got to do it the best way that you know how. And then if it doesn't work for the person that you're cutting for, they'll tell you that it doesn't work, and they'll let you know, and then you learn, you know, okay, this is how they would want it, this is how they want. But I think when you're taking your best shot, you just have to trust your instincts, and, you know, and then, but also be open to criticism and being, you know, hearing it and not taking it personally, but, you know, being open to it and being open to changing things.
And then I will expound on that, because that is advice that I got from Lynne. I called her one day on a show, and I'm like, they're giving notes that really are not in my wheelhouse. I don't even think like this. And she told me they hired you because they've seen the other work that you do, and they like that. So do what you would do. Do your instincts would tell you until they tell you to change it. And that's what I did. And so I passed that on to Chris.
That's great.
And I will also say that on every single job that I start, even the pilot that I just finished, I get nervous about, oh, am I cutting this the way they want? What should I do? Should I change what I usually do because of this? And no, not really.
The answer is no.
They'll tell you, and if they really don't like what you do, they'll fire you. Don't take that personal. It happens to everybody nowadays. Hopefully it won't. Hopefully they'll do you, you know, right, and they will ask you to change it. You know, they hired you for a reason, and you should do what, you know, your instincts say. That's what Lynne taught me. And
this is, for me, a perfect example of what mentorship should be, the exchange of information both ways. Advice that's not just about, wait, how do I use fluid morph, right? It's really much more about all of the core stuff that makes us good storytellers. So this is great. I want to thank Lynne Willingham, Kelley Dixon, Chris McCaleb, and thank you.